you the mic. Now, Mr. Graham, I know you're the principal of Maggotty High School. Can you share with us what has that been like so far?
Well, it has been a fulfilling experience, you know, Mr. Chisholm. Knowing where we're coming from, especially working at the same institution, entering this institution as an entry-level worker, working in the bursar's office as a clerical officer, leaving the institution to be trained as a teacher, coming back, teaching at the institution, and going through the ranks, you know, the various positions, and now to be at the highest executive position of the school, of which my mother was a teacher. It's really a fulfilling experience.
So what has the journey been like coming from a clerical worker to teacher to principal right at the top?
Well, it has been an interesting journey, you know. When we look at it and, you know, sit and reflect, it seems surreal at times, but it seems as if along the way God has been preparing me for being in this position. Yes, I have friends along the way, somebody like yourself and other teachers, students that serve as motivators and propelled to always want to do better. So the journey has been interesting, but more than all, it has been fulfilling, because in the journey, we are taking care of the lives of children. That is my passion.
Now, I'm going to share something with my viewers. I always remember the story that I've shared with others. I'm not sure if I've shared it in your presence. I can remember about 2008 when you were going back to study and you said, I want to come back as an administrator. And I believe by 2011 you come back as an administrator. And then you move from just being an administrator to the principal in another couple of years. Now, how did that come about? Did you believe at the beginning that, hey, you're going to be an administrator or even principal?
Well, you see, Mr. Chisholm, and this is the value of our friends, because there are a number of things that came together and came together properly. And though you do believe that, we have to give a lot of that to you. I've always been a reader of motivational books and watching motivational tips. And I remember when I, you know, had a discussion with you and our late friend, Cassandra Roberts Yara, where we were reading these books, and you always said something to me that it's pointless to be reading the book and applying the principles. And one of the principles that we learned was the power of positive thinking. And inherent in the power of positive thinking is that you must dream what you want, pursue it, and speak it into being. And so that was a reflection of that in 2008 when I was going out to study. I reflected and said, you know, my dream is to come back and be a school administrator where I will be in a position to better help the children so that they can grow up and fulfill their life's dream.
Okay, wonderful. So let me ask you though, I've heard someone describe you at some point as a man for our season. They say you're involved in every little thing. Sometimes you're in sports, you're in speech, you're in drama. How do you do all of that and still remain focused and your main objectives?
You see, essentially, all of that is working for your children. God, that is really the passion. To work with the children so that the inner genius and greatness of each child can be unearthed. And so my journey at Maggotty from before, I decided that I was going to use my talent. So even while I was working in the bursar's office, I was writing songs, doing dramatic pieces with my mother. When I came to the institution, I decided to work with the school's choir, even though I can't sing, still can't sing. Decided that I'm going to do speech and drama. Decided at a point when the students came to me overwhelmingly and determined, and this was driven by the student, that Maggotty High School should be a part of school children's music competition. And just feeling the drive from there, I entered. Working with students in the house, students wanting to your house to do well, and students pulling on it, it drives you into a different era. But with all the different things that you do, it comes back to doing your best to serve the children that are in front of you, that when they go out, and even while they're living, they can be the best person and the best version of themselves.
Okay, well, I want to ask you though, what was that like? I remember that whole entering school challenge quiz, that for that particular year you were the best in school. And I must also make mention that the gentleman actually doing the videography was a member of that particular team, Ryan Brown. How did that make you feel? Entering for the first time, winning, and then at the end you were named the best new school.
Trust me, Mr. Chisholm, that was one of the most fulfilling experiences of my life. And I believe that was something that motivated me and has motivated me to where I am today, because it was a challenge that we took up in about November after the students came, and they came in droves, and they wanted to enter school children's quiz, because when we did the singing competition, because first altogether singing competition, very first taping was done at Wall Theater, Maggotty High School was there. And the students felt that, you know, seeing themselves on TV, because at that time Maggotty was not so exposed and entering events, especially national events. And so they came overwhelmingly. And for the first meeting, we had about 15 students. But slowly, when the pressure came on, and I had to be learning as a coach, the students started to drift, and then it came down to five young men: Ryan, Boy, Chris, O'Brien, and Sharon. And when it came down to them, we decided that we were going to put in the work. The Christmas holidays, we were working. Mr. Ben, principal, then paid for us to stay at a little guest house. We worked into the night, 2, 3 o'clock in the mornings, and we prepared well. And they motivated me because I was also learning as a coach. Because there were many things that I did not know. And I had to stretch myself. And but what gave me motivation was that the young men, they were willing to put in the work. And I admired that about them. And when I saw the passion that they were putting, I couldn't do any less than putting by the same passion. And that caused the results that we have.
Okay, so you were driven by the passion of others. Yes. Also, speaking of entering competition, their school recently placed second in altogether sixth. What was that like for you and the school community?
That was one of the most captivating moments of the school and the school life. The competition is a singing competition, and you know the school normally would enter the competition, but after 2 or 3 rounds it became a gift that we would be out. But then the choir director and also the culture agent, Ms. K. Forbes, they came, and especially Ms. K. Forbes had a vision that we could do this year. And so it was about them preparing and preparing well to the choir director. But given the type of competition it was about the culture agent organizing the students and the school family to get behind in terms of support, getting monies together to do the voting, and allowing us to start to believe. And it served as a great motivator to the students of the school and the teachers of the school, where we started to believe. We actually believed that we could do something great. And though we did not win the competition, I believe that it helped to develop in students a sort of self-confidence that was never before seen in Maggotty High School students.
Oh, okay. You do mention, more than once you mention vision. Quite a few times you talk about vision. What is a vision to you, and what part does vision play in your role from moving from just a regular worker to the head of an administration? And no doubt, you'll be going other places too.
Yes, sir. Vision, it's working. It's working on the imagination to think of where you want to get to, both as individual, because I think you cannot have vision for an organization if you don't have a vision for yourself. And so it's inner working of the mind, because it's all the things that we do, the mind is given to us from memory, so we can remember, and I think a lot of time we spend time focusing on the past. But a vision though is using the mind as an imaginary tool to look forward into years or days or months to come in terms of what you want to achieve. And so you do it at an individual level. You come into a space where you say, this is where I want to be in 5 years. You sit, you think about it, you imagine it so that you can almost taste it or smell it, such as that. It becomes real. And so even though you are in the moment, you are not in the moment. And people will understand you. You say your school will be at this position. And people will say, oh, but this is where your school is at. But while you are in the moment, you are seeing it, you are seeing what the school can achieve, you are seeing what the students can do. And you know, you see that, as I said, at an individual level, you see it for your family, you see it for whatever organization you work in. And after a while, what our vision does, it radiates a heat that draws other people to fall in line, and situation to fall in line to push you towards that.
So if I make it correctly, you're saying that you should be able to see the outcome vividly,
yes,
before you even start,
yes,
the journey.
Yes, yes.
Okay. But let me ask you this one, as I mentioned, starting up the journey, because I know now you're an administrator of a lovely high school. But what was your upbringing like? What was leading up to this genre of being principal of Maggotty High School? And no doubt, greater things to come.
Yes, upbringing was tough. We were not really poor in the strictest sense of the word, because we have seen really poor persons. But my mother was a teacher, and my father worked at Albert as a plumber, but after a while he got laid off. All my siblings went to boarding institutions, Monroe Hampton, Yale, and those were expensive institutions. At the time, I can imagine that they is still our expensive institution. And so it was tough. We had to go through a lot in terms of being disciplined, making sacrifices, especially my mother made a lot of sacrifice. But one thing she insisted on is that we get a good education and we get good grounding in the church and in the world. And that helped to propel us. But if I should really start to talk about that, I don't think you would have time to accommodate that.
Okay, well, I want to ask you something, because I had the opportunity to talk to your mother, who's quite a little late, and also your father. Yes. But she shared a story with me, and once, and she was saying that you love boxing back in the day.
Yes.
That you absolutely love boxing. But she also said that there was a point when you weren't doing so well in school, and she was thinking of throwing away the boxing books and all the boxing material. And then it struck her that she should actually use these materials to encourage her interest in other things.
Yes.
What was that like for you?
You know, it has been one of the most vivid things as it relates to teaching and learning when I decided to become a teacher. I was motivated to become a teacher by my interaction with one Mr. Miller, who is now the principal at City Pagan. But I remember at the time I became so fascinated by boxing. At that time it was at my TV, but they used to have a program on Thursday night. I was fascinated with Mike Tyson, Mike McConnell, Lyle Elegant, all these great boxers, and I wanted them to become a boxer. So every lunchtime I would get some boxing, some boxers, and put it on, and we'd be powering with the other persons around. I became fascinated, began to distract from work. I was in grade 3. And the grade 3 teacher at the time, Miss Sia, was riding her bike past. You know, she stopped and she felt obligated to make a report. And I used to get a lot of cable magazines with a lot of boxing material. And I used to get them all the time. I was reading them into the library. And what my mother did was, at the time, she started to find ways to teach mathematics in terms of the weight division and how much person should be in what weight. She brought up religious education in there because she was reminding us of the Muhammad Ali as a Muslim. Chipper Berwick as a Christian, she found a way to bring social studies so you would know how to research the country that the boxer is from, the capital of the country. And it has always served to me that what the mind I was teaching, that if we make learning interesting and fun, we can pull out the thing that we need out of children. We have to just tap into their interests.
So I'm actually seeing that your mother was grooming it to be a teacher.
Yes, so yes,
it
was
intelligent. And it is interesting that they have become one and at the head of a particular institution. But you also mentioned religion and Christianity, and I know that you're a Christian. What part does that play in you being who you are as a person?
It is the fundamental of Mr. Chisholm. The Bible says that seek ye first the kingdom of God and his righteousness, and all things shall be added. And I essentially believe that we are not just human beings. As a matter of fact, I think we are human spirits before human beings, and therefore we should live life from the spirit. And if we live life from the spirit, then physical things will fall in place. And I use that as a reference point in terms of relationship with spirit, with God, and that determines your life and, you know, the successes and even failures and challenges that you'll experience in life, and that will help you to deal with whatever comes.
Oh, okay. But talk to me a little bit about that, the spirit. I know most persons just think of the spirit of something abstract, something that you can really get a hold of. But how does that work really in your life?
Yes, one of the things I think we have been trained by society, by family, by the education system, and even the church and religion in general, to depend more on sense perception, physical, what we can see, what we can feel, what we can touch. But if anybody within your own experiences know that there is something deeper, there is something greater, if you look in the mirror, who is looking at who, what is driving you, there has to be an overall essence that is really who you are, and that is what drives you. And it is a complicated and deep concept, but I think everybody is aware that there is a greater part to who you are than just the body. But it is a concept again that would need more time for exploration and discussion.
Oh, okay. But I must mention, though, as I say, you talk about spirit and then you talk about vision. And in your mind, is this a necessary component when you are reaching towards that particular vision?
Yes, ma'am. Because the visible comes from the invisible. Because God said, and then he saw. And we use our imagination and we think things and they become. And so there is a greater force that is driving us towards our destiny. And it is that we have to tap into if we are going to be successful. And as it relates into vision, they will cut up vision, because part of the Bible says that we walk by faith and not by sight, because sight is limited. Sight only deals with sense perception of what is before you. No. But then you have, there is a deeper sight, an insight that is within your brain that enables imagination to see, even though it's not in front of you.
Oh, okay. Wonderful. Now, here's something that I really want to tell you. Now, back in my days, when you talk about principles, and you envision somebody in their 50s, late 40s, 50s, probably 60s. How is it for you as a young man somewhere in your mid-30s to become principal of an institution? And not only that, you would have had persons there who you have come in contact with when probably you were even a student.
Yes.
And then you have to come in and you are in charge of all of these persons. How does it work? How do you get around it as it relates to respect, or you deal with them, knowing that this person used to bring me a problem as a child, and now I am in charge, and even though you're not going to lord everything over them, but you still have to speak to them in a particular way that demands or commands their respect?
Yes. That's very interesting, actually. Very good question. The thing is that you don't get too caught up in yourself, and I think humility is very important. Because you have to remember when you work with people, especially in terms of leadership, it's one, being respectful, and it's two, holding persons accountable. So you hold persons accountable, and then you must also be able to be held accountable. And there are members of staff here that knew me when I was a little boy running up and down in Maggotty at events that my mother brought me. That would be like 5, 6, they have seen me grow. There are members of staff here who knew me when I was in first form at Monroe, and they were already teachers in the system. There are members of staff here who would have known my mother and know the background they're coming from. But as we grow, and I get a lot of my leadership ideas from John Maxwell, and one thing that he always emphasizes is that leadership is about influence. So I don't think we should get ahead of ourselves in terms of trying to lord over people, trying to be strict and to be demanding of others. But what we should do is lead by example, but being humble enough at points to hold persons accountable regardless of their age. You do it in a respectful way, keeping your eye on the bottom line. And the bottom line of the institution is that we are here to serve the students.
Mark, now here's something that I want to ask, because I know a lot of times when we are sharing our successes and we really focus a lot on our successes, but I'm sure you would have had some disappointments along the way. Mm-hmm. How do you handle them? I mean, how do you learn to discipline your disappointments?
Well, you see, I remember my mother again taught me a very important lesson. I remember leaving one, we sing sometimes at one, when we got to the exam result, I got four subjects. Four subjects. At that time, my mother was like, at the bottom, because all the friends would be no way to sixth form. I was in depression in such a time for a week. When I said depression, I mean deep depression. I was locked up in the room. And I looked at the result, math and English was not there. Just the four subjects in my mind. At that time, when you had four subjects, you really felt wasted.
Right.
So I was really, really depressed. Really depressed. And I wondered, because I knew my mother had spent a lot of money to have my mother in college and his prestige. Going out there in the community where people had this great expectation of him, because he went to Monroe College. I was really down and was crying in the room. And she came in and she said, you already wasted time. So there's no need to cry. And she said something to me, you need to get up now, dress yourself up and go back home. And that has always served me, and it has always served as a motivator. That when life happens to you, you have to view the situation, but you have to look back in the mirror and say, yes, I'm going to fight again. Because the victory will come and the reward will come to the person that's finished the race. Many persons stop partway and then become envious of the person who finished. And so my life drive is that, like Paul, I want to say, I've finished my course. So I am not going to stop in between, because while disappointment will come in between, it's when you are at the end that you can look back and realize that those things turn out, even disappointment, they were the stepping stones.
Oh, okay. Well, next thing I want to ask is this, I know you have inspired a lot of persons, you have tried to motivate persons, students, but I don't know you have persons of your own, and I mean your very own, that you are now responsible for to motivate. So I want to ask, what is family life like? And I know with your children, how do you go about motivate them and keep them grounded? What is it overall as a family, and what part does it play in how you do what you do?
Yeah, well, family is very important, such as your wife, your children. Those things are essential as it relates to your own success and your own grounding, and you find success in them. And especially as it relates to my children, one of the key things that I've learned is that we must allow them to be who they are. And for many times we try, especially as educators, we want to impose our way on them. And so I try to allow a relaxing environment, but a relaxing environment of focus, where they are who they are, because my children mainly are dramatic and into the arts, not so much driven by academics, even though they will do well in their academic work. But I try to ascertain what is within them, allow them to be relaxed, and then serve as a motivator, especially using prayer and words to speak well over them and to allow them to see me pursuing excellence. I remember when I was doing my master's degree, my first daughter was 4 years old, and I am not a fan of graduation in that time, because that man, we didn't graduate, we just left the school. So, but I remember being motivated by her at age 4 and saying, you know what, I'm going to allow her to see a model of excellence. That she will remember that I went to my father's graduation and he got his master's degree. That even while growing up, that will be a motivator for her even to do that and even to accomplish more. And so, my wife is now doing her master's, and you know, she's not interested in the graduation. And I said, you have to do it for them. Not necessarily because you really want to go through the process of graduation, or allow them to see a model of excellence right in front of them, and that will sort of give you the
way. Oh, okay. Wonderful. So what's next for Mr. Graham? I mean, I know you have a master's, you are a principal of a developing high school that is, I know, is going to be one of the best or something. What's next for Mr. Graham?
What's next for Mr. Chisholm is your service, you know, to serve God and to serve people, serve my family, and to, because I have looked at life and see that, you know, I've accomplished many things. And so the next quest is to be very rich so I can serve others.
Well, Mr. Graham, thank you very much for coming. And I know there are great things waiting in store. And we are going to motivate and teach the world. And I thank you very much for listening. I hope you were motivated by a show.